What's up guys, Limcube here, and in this video I'm gonna teach you all new strats for the Great Plateau in Breath of the Wild in the any% speedrun that I think you should learn if you're learning the game, if you're a newcomer, or if you are pushing towards that sub 30 minute mark. So this video is basically made as an update for my original any% tutorial, and it's just gonna go over the strats that I think are actually worth still picking up on top of that. Thankfully, the original tutorial is actually pretty up to date. There's not too many differences. The route is pretty much the same, but there is a couple of strats that are definitely worth learning, in my opinion, now in 2021. And at the beginning, I want to go over a typical debate. Should I run the game with Amiibo or without Amiibo? And in my opinion, now in 2021, again, you should run Breath of the Wild any% with Amiibo. In this video, which is just going to go over the Great Plateau, we will only be talking about one strat that's Amiibo exclusive. I will also show the no Amiibo strat for that. But when we get to the second video, which is going to be all about Hyrule Castle, which actually got a reroute recently in March 2021, I will exclusively cover the Amiibo route. And I know a lot of you might want to run the game with no Amiibo, but there is already a tutorial for no Amiibo Hyrule Castle out there that I'm going to link in that video's description, but I will talk about Amiibo, and here's why. Amiibo in this time not only saves a lot of time, but also makes the run actually a lot easier. And the new Hyrule Castle is already tricky enough, and there's a route that I very much recommend for everybody that wants to beat the game in under 30 minutes, which is picking up 6 ancient arrows and scanning Amiibo in Hyrule Castle to get your attack up potion. So that's what I'm going to be covering in my tutorial. But here on Plateau, I will cover, and the only strat that really matters there is the movement from the Bomb Shrine to the Temple of Time. I will cover the no Amiibo and Amiibo version for that, but in general I recommend Amiibo because it's faster, the top 10 all play the game on Amiibo, and it just makes the run much more forgiving. My opinion, get Amiibo. In the next video I will talk about which ones you're free to use NFC cards, which are very cheap to get. If you want to pick this up and take this game seriously, that's what you should do at this point in time, but let's get this started. So the first strat that I want to talk about is something that you have probably seen if you watched a Breath of the Wild any% speedrun world record. So once you clip out of the Shrine of Resurrection, which is covered in my original tutorial, you have a choice to make. You can go down here to the Podlet, which is what I recommend and I've always done. That's what basically is covered in my tutorial. Or you can take a very precise path to the right here, skip the shield down there and basically make your way straight to this Bokoblin camp over there. One of the Bokus there has a shield, a Boku shield, and you can use that shield instead. Now this route saves up to 10 seconds, which seems pretty good. 10 seconds is quite a lot of time, but your Boku shield is much weaker, which means if you're newer to the game and you're going to land your shield on the surface too much, it's actually going to break. The durability of the Boku shield is only, I think, 4. So you can only get to land 4 times on the surface. You can kind of manipulate the durability a little bit, but I highly, highly advise against this strat. Like, even some of the players in the top 5 will not go for the Boku shield route, because not only is it hard to deal with the Boku shield, but getting the Boku shield in of itself is already tricky. I can, if you want to, here show you quickly the movement that runners usually take if they do go for the Boku shield, but I really, really advise against it. It's not even free to save time with it. I'm going to go over this quickly, but I will advise against it heavily. So in the Boku shield route after coming out of the Shrine of Resurrection, you want to jump over the snow here and run into this area. In this area, your cold damage is basically reset because it's not cold here if you look at the temperature counter. So we can make our way towards here. You want to make sure that you jump over the snow here because the snow will drastically slow you down. And you want to make sure to take the most direct line to the Woodcutter's Axe. The later we lose our half heart here, and it was a little bit before the Woodcutter's Axe, the better. The problem with this route is no matter what you do, after getting the Boku shield, you are going to be at 1 HP, which means you have to somehow reset your cold damage again. In my case, I'm going to use the campfire from the Bokoblin camp to reset that cold damage, but also showcase as to why this is so ridiculous. By the way, I'm running on the stones here because Link has a little bit more sprinting speed there, and I'm also going to run to the right instead of shield surfing, which I obviously can't without a shield, to the mountain here because I only need to climb pop twice to make it up to the arrows. And you can already see my hearts are already at 1, and I'm about to lose one more. So what I need to do is I need to get this Bokushield as quick as possible and reset my cold damage as quick as possible by running into the campfire over there. The problem is the Boku with the bow is also going to start shooting at me quicker. And also this guy is about to attack me again, so you can already see how scary this can really get. Now, I'm also pretty slow here with my shield surfing speed, and I hope I don't lose my next heart too quickly. But it looks like I will barely make it here, because I just lost my half heart. So here, I should actually be able to make this Bokoblin shield route work. However, I think you could easily see why this is so hard. If I got hit there at any point, I would have immediately died. And also, in this route, you don't pick up any food, so you won't have backup food for the rest of your run. Your shield is incredibly weak. I can actually show this off here by trying to get skew a couple times. I think, see, after the second time, it already says my Boku shield is badly damaged, which means from this point on, I would always have to unequip and re-equip my shield to make sure that I'm not losing durability. So most of the time, you will barely even save time with it. And yes, it will save a little bit of time, but if you're not going for the world record, I don't think the strat is worth it in your runs. Now, also keep in mind, I'm playing the game in English here, by the way, and this is only to explain the items a little bit better. French is still the fastest language. Nothing has changed there. I will now show you guys the actual first strat that, in my opinion, is worth learning in your new Any% runs in 2021, which is the 4-hit boulder launch strat. And I'll see you guys when I actually picked up a potlet. Now, the first strat that, in my opinion, is worth learning and updating your Any% trick arsenal with is the 4-hit boulder stasis launch. This trick happens right after you finish the stasis shrine, you get the stasis rune, and you talk to the monk, and then you talk to the old man, because this is the first shrine you're going to do. Now, in the past, in my previous tutorial, I taught you how to make it up this hill by hitting this boulder 3 times, and the 4-hit strat is basically the same, it is just slightly more optimized. At first, I will show you how this actually looks like. That's the trick, and you can already see, instead of landing over there, which is where we used to land with the 3-hit strat, we are now here. This allows us to take a very optimal shield surfing path to the next BTB spot, where we can basically just shield surf down here, and then we are right at the BTB spot. This is why this trick saves between 2 and 3 seconds, and I recommend learning it because it's not too hard to do, and it's easy to learn. So now I'm going to show you how to actually do it. So all we need to do to learn this setup instead is to switch Link's positioning and his arrow shot, and obviously also hit the boulder 4 times. So I like to stand where these 2 big white lines meet. There's one here on the boulder and one here, and a pretty generous area as to where I like to position Link. Here I hit the boulder 4 times, crouch down, and then you can kind of see a line here. So there's like a little corner in the rock here and a little corner there. So basically the line that connects these two. And I just like to shoot like in the general area, like the middle of it, after charging up the boulder. If anything, maybe a little bit more on the right, but kind of like in this general area is where you want to shoot your arrow to get the right line to make it up here. Now, one thing that I actually forgot to mention in my first tutorial is I like using gyro to aim up the bow here. It allows you to go a lot quicker, and you're obviously kind of working against time when you're doing this trick. And the faster you do this, basically, the earlier you are able to unstasis the boulder, which is actually going to save time in your speedruns. So let's try to do this once again with stasis activated. So we'd stasis the boulder, hit it 4 times in the right spot, crouch down, shoot like on top of this line, get up, unstasis. And what I like to do at the end here is I like to backflip off of the boulder. Basically just for style points, you could also just jump down in any direction. So let's also quickly talk about the shield surf that we want to do after we land here with the 4-hit boulder strat, and then we want to go over here, right, to the Bokoblins and do the Cryonis BTB. What I like to do is I like to shield jump over these brushes here and then do two shield hops. You could see to basically keep your optimal momentum. At this point, you are at the Cryonis BTB spot, which is basically still the same. You just wait until the Bokoblin is almost at the spot you shot, go into bullet time, and then make your way to the Cryonis Shrine, which there is a different clip for getting into the Cryonis Shrine using an extended shield clip, which I made a video on before. I'm gonna link it in this video's description. So I actually recommend going for the extended shield clip here. I'm quickly gonna try to do it here. Basically, you wanna get your skew at the top of the shrine and then clip through the door instead of clipping through the side, which is what I recommend. I'm gonna link the video in the description. That's the move into Cryonis now. Definitely save some time and I recommend learning this. So once again, if you watched the recent world record of this game, you might know that there is a new strat inside Cryonis where you are able to jump over this gate by doing a wall jump up here, a mid-air fall damage cancel, resetting your jump, and then shield jumping over, and then you can basically use the cryo skip strategy to make it up there. Now this trick saves, I think, around 4 seconds optimally, but I highly, once again, advise against it. There is a tutorial by Sly that I'm gonna link in the tutorial if you do want to learn this, but I personally really don't like the strat. You can try it out. Physically, it hurts my hands. It fails most of the time, and once again, unless you're going for the top 10 time, there is really better things that you might want to focus on instead, really like saving these seconds in this shrine. If you want to do it though, I will link Sly's video tutorial on this trick in the description. I personally recommend you guys still go for the Cryonis skip mentioned in my first video tutorial. The next strategy that I want to teach you guys is a strategy called Slate Storage. This mechanic is basically an easy way to fall damage cancel with the press of a single button, which speedrunners like to use when they BTB from the Cryonis to the Magnesis Shrine, because the traditional fall damage cancel can be quite hard. In order to get into the Slate Storage state, we need to run down or up a slope and then swing our axe while running. When we run and swing our axe, the animation looks like this. When I do this while running up the slope here, I'm now in Slate Storage state. What this allows me to do is jump off any cliff and basically cancel out every fall damage. I will demonstrate this by jumping down this cliff. All you need to do to activate Slate Storage is press any menu button. I'm going to use the D-pad here. And you could see Link didn't take any fall damage. The reason this works is because the first time you play Breath of the Wild on a new file, there is a unique animation of Link pulling out the Sheikah Slate when he opens the map. This animation only happens once, and by doing those inputs I did here, you can store this animation. I will show this animation now once by pressing the map button. I loaded back my file, so on this file technically, the animation never happened. I'm pressing minus, and this is the animation that you can essentially store. During this animation, Link is invincible, and this is what we basically abuse to be able to Slate Storage and avoid taking fall damage on BTBs or high falls. Now, once this animation has played, you can no longer do Slate Storage. So if you mess up in your run and you see this animation play, the one that just played, you will not be able to do this trick anymore. So in a real speedrun, you would spawn here after leaving the Cryonis Shrine. And then this slope is what you want to use to get into Slate Storage state. Once again, I loaded the file, so now I will be able to do it. So I'm going to run, swing my axe, and then press minus. And what happened here is that the map opened without the animation ever playing. What this means is that you can actually attempt to do Slate Storage again. You did the setup slightly wrong, but the cutscene still hasn't played, so you are allowed to perform the same inputs again, like I did here, and it worked, and now in Slate Storage. Only when you see the actual animation of Link pulling out the Sheikah Slate, you are no longer able to perform the glitch. The Magnesis BTB is still the same. I'm not getting a perfect angle here, but this doesn't actually matter. This is good to show you guys how Slate Storage looks in a run. Also, when you are in Slate Storage state, you cannot not press any menu button, because as soon as you do, like here, Slate Storage will play, basically allowing Link to quickly fall damage cancel. So you run up the slope, swing your axe, and press the map button. And I actually did it wrong here, so you saw the cutscene play because I didn't run up a slope. If you see this, you can't do the trick anymore. You have to do the traditional fall damage cancel. If you just see the map open, you can redo it. And if you don't see the map open and not the animation, but you pressed all buttons, you are in Slate Storage state. Slate Storage state, that's a hard word. And you can go for the BTB, and then you just need to press any menu button in the air to get a free fall damage cancel. Now let's do this once again in a full attempt. We leave the Cryonis Shrine, we come up to these brushes, We X-Swing, the map opened, which means we can do it again. We try it again. This time it worked. We walk to the corner, do the normal BTB step to Magnesis that I teach in the first video tutorial series. Make sure to check that out. You should have watched this already when you're watching this video. And then I go for the BTB to Magnesis. And this time I actually have a good angle, which is going to allow me to showcase why Slate Storage can be so good. Because I'm going to be pretty close to the shrine here, it would be really, really hard to do a normal fall damage cancel. So instead, I'm just going to be able to press D-pad up just before I land. Like this. And normally, I would have never gotten the fall damage cancel here, but I was still able to because of the Slate Storage trick. So now I would just clip into the Magnesis Shrine. And this can definitely help improve your Magnesis splits, because sometimes these BTBs are just too low, like in this time. And I really recommend picking up Slate Storage to fix that issue. It actually is technically slightly slower than the normal fall damage cancel, but I still highly recommend it. Now, I want to talk about the movement from Magnesis to bombs and why I don't want you guys to change anything about it. There's basically three strategies to go from Magnesis to bombs. The first one is the one that I taught in my first tutorial. You come over here. You pick up the slab with Magnesis, you place it dipping into the water pond in the top, and then you stasis it full and ride it over to the Bokoblin camp, and then you BTB. There is a strategy that saves 4 seconds, which is called Box Walk. Instead of ever using Magnesis, you switch to stasis, you jump down here and stasis this box, and then walk on the box as its stasis launches over the river. The strat saves about 4 seconds and is another example that I would only recommend for top 10, maybe top 20 runners. I'm gonna teach you how to do it here, but I will highly advise against it. And I would say, please use the slab unless you're going for an absolute top tier time. There is one more strat, the legendary stasis bounce, where you essentially grab this box, place it in a specific angle, charge it up fully with stasis, and try to ride the box all the way to the bomb shrine. This is how this can look like, and ideally you want to get a shield spin on the ground here to then fly all the way. I cannot believe I'm literally recording this first take and I instantly got it. I was about to tell you to not do the strat ever. Okay, maybe you shouldn't, because you can still mess up the fall damage cancel. This strat saves about 11 seconds, but getting the actual bounce, I know I made it look kind of okay there, is actually super, super unlikely. I made a tutorial on this trick on my YouTube channel, which I'm also gonna link in the video's description, but please don't mess with it. This trick isn't even in the world record right now, and I highly advise against it. I recommend you guys go for the slab launch that I taught in my first tutorial, but I will now teach you how to do the box walk, even though I'm not a big fan of it. So when you leave Magnesis and you want to do box walk, the first thing you want to do is switch your rune to stasis. Then you want to jump down on this side of the box, stasis it, and hit the box 4 times. Then you want to get in a very specific location. You want to get on the left side of the box, crouch down, and then aim all the way up with the bow, and then down again. You can only get this view of the box if you first aim all the way up and then down again. Otherwise, you cannot get this position, so you're not able to shoot the perfect visual cue. The visual cue is basically, if you look at this emblem on the box, there's kind of 3 squares over the, I'm assuming, shield. You want to shoot over this square on the box. Once again, I'm trying to get into the right position, aiming all the way up. This is the square, and you want to shoot over it. That's the setup for box walk. Unfortunately, that's only where the hard part begins. So you jump down, stasis the box, hit it 4 times, aim all the way up, shoot the right part, climb onto the box, turn around, and then you want to walk on the box over to the Bokoblin camp to then do the BTB. This always looks very cool when it works, but unfortunately, it doesn't always work, which is the main problem with this trick. Many problems can happen, and this is where I'm not going to go much more into it. You can fall off the box, you can not make it all the way. If you fall off the box in the wrong spot, you can actually die which means a 4-second time save could end up costing you your entire run. And the slap launch is so consistent, and it also looks very cool. So unless you really want to push the game to the next level, you can use this to learn how to box walk, but I personally don't recommend it. I quickly want to talk about the shield clip into the bomb shrine. This seemed to be the number one issue that people had from the original tutorial. At this point, you should already know how to shield clip because you obviously watched the tutorial, so I don't have to explain skew again. You want to get your skew on this little bean. It's almost like a literal bean. This is where I like to get my skew, jumping with the shield against it. And then you want to look at the V, also something I showed in the tutorial. There's like a little V here, a black line. You want Link's head to be just on the right of it. And then you want to look at the field of view lines. The left field of view line should be just on the left of the dot. And then your shield clip. And you're in the first wall. Now the second clip is where most people had issues with. You want to basically come up to the left here. You want to basically walk a little bit forward, a little bit left. You can see this like floating texture right next to the elevator. You want to be able to see this texture. You have your camera on the right. And the hardest part here is that you want to do something that you usually don't do when you shield clip. You're going to do an instant shield jump and then instantly unequip your shield. Like if you look at this, you wouldn't think this is going to work if you normally know how to shield clip. But in this case, it does. You want to instantly unequip your shield. And that's something that many people struggled with. Hopefully this helps you with clipping into bombs. Just a little bit of an update because some people had issues with it. Let's go into bombs and learn the biggest trick in the run. And when I say biggest trick, I mean biggest new trick. AKA using wind bombs in bombs and also going to the Temple of Time. Now, wind bombs are a major discovery in Breath of the Wild. I have a very big video on how to wind bomb 30 minutes. It takes very long to learn. And before you come here and you want to learn these wind bombs, learn how to wind bomb. Because these wind bombs are going to be a little bit different. These wind bombs are going to be without having the paraglider. If you don't have the paraglider, wind bombs are actually quite bad. You take a lot of damage when you do them. And there's only two wind bombs, usually 2 to 3 wind bombs in the run before you have the paraglider. This is also why we don't go to the bomb shrine first. People would say this seems super fast, wind bombs are broken. But without the paraglider, they're actually not that great. There is two wind bombs that people like to do in the bomb shrine. I'm going to teach both and everything about it. But before you move on to this video, make sure that you know how to wind bomb with a paraglider. That's what you're going to need if you want to do this trick. If you can't wind bomb, you can't do these strategies. These wind bombs save between 7 and 11 seconds, depending on which one. I think actually up to 12 if you get the perfect so-called Gaber wind bomb. And I will teach both of them. But once again, make sure before I even get the bombs rune here, you know how to wind bomb, then you can learn this. If not, I won't teach you how to wind bomb here. I will teach you how to do the wind bombs in and outside of bombs. So if you don't know that yet, watch my video, come back, and I will teach you then. But for the people that already know, let's learn these ones. So before we get into the wind bombs within the bomb shrine, we need to talk about something in this game called glitched ragdoll. It's a very weird mechanic, and it basically makes it so that Link cannot launch if you have previously done a shield jump and unequip your shield mid-air. This will cause Link to be in a state called glitched ragdoll state, where any launch, a stasis launch, or a wind bomb will fail. So if we want to do these wind bombs, we want to get rid of this glitched ragdoll state. There's two ways of getting rid of the glitched ragdoll state. One is to do a neutral shield jump by holding out your shield, shield jumping, and then unequipping your shield in the spot we are gonna do the wind bomb on. However, even though this is fast, this trick is fairly inconsistent. And if you really want to make sure that you get rid of the glitched ragdoll state, you want to actually perform a real ragdoll. Now, I personally don't do this, but if you start out, I really recommend you to do the strategy. Because when you come into the bomb shrine, you are going to be in the glitched ragdoll state. This is because you clipped into the bomb shrine. And obviously when you clip in a shrine, you unequip your shield mid shield jump. So you're going to be in that glitched state, which means your wind bomb here is going to fail. But there is a way to make sure it 100% works. What you want to do is when you enter bombs, you want to jump towards the pedestal where you get the rune. And when you are on your shield, landing the shield serve, you want to unequip it. Then Link is gonna ragdoll. Now the glitched ragdoll is gone, and every wind bomb will work. Trust me, it will fail 90% of the time if you don't do this. So I highly recommend getting rid of the state by doing this, and now we can actually focus on the wind bomb, starting by getting the rune. So once you get the bomb rune, you are free to choose which wind bomb you want to use. Do you want to use the easy one? And I highly recommend that, that always saves time. Or do you want to use the cool one that works like 20% of the time, saves more time, but looks cooler? Don't do that. I will teach it anyway for the style points, but I highly recommend to go for this one. So the easy wind bomb is done by lining up Link with this shadow. This shadow on the ground here is always going to be consistent. This is where we want to stand on by holding the ZL button. And we want to make sure that Link's right foot is down on the ramp and his left foot is still barely up on the surface. You can see how he's positioned right now. Now we want to set the angle for the wind bomb. And I like to do this by using throw aim, just like many setups in this game. And I use the top and bottom lines of the crosshair, basically aiming in the middle of these two rocks. There's a rock on the left and a rock on the right. I position my crosshair just in the middle of them. Now we need to make sure that we have the bomb equipped, and we do a classic forward wind bomb. This will send us all the way over here, sometimes down into the pit, sometimes up there. You can actually die to this wind bomb. And if you really want to make sure that you survive this, you can eat food as you do it to make sure that you don't die from ragdoll damage. I didn't there. I got lucky. If you want to be safe, eat some food. Specifically, if you can see you're going to be landing more in this area than in this area. But obviously, this skips the entire early part of the shrine. So all you need to do after landing here is just blowing up the rocks like usual. And then you're basically done with the shrine. You can climb up the ladder and you can make it towards the monk. This is a very basic front top wind bomb that basically allows you to skip the early part of the shrine. But I will now teach you the so-called gamer wind bomb, which is very inconsistent. Looks really cool. Maybe in a run where you are behind, you might want to try it. It actually sends you all the way from the beginning to the shrine to the end. And I will show you how this works. Now, in order to learn how to do the gamer wind bomb, which sends you all the way to the monk of the shrine, you need to know how to do something called a turn wind bomb. Turn wind bombs are an advanced wind bomb, and a community member by the name of Vivo made a great tutorial on them, which I will link in the video's description. So make sure you know how to turn wind bomb before you even attempt this. This trick is very inconsistent, but I'm going to teach it to you anyway. You want to run back to the beginning of the shrine and then make sure that you face the two rocks, the two broken rocks, to basically line up Link so that he can side hop onto this elevator pack. This is what we're going to use to basically get into bullet time. We then want to set our visual cue for the initial jump, which is going to be the crack in the left part of these two boulders. The left boulder starts at the bottom, goes up, and then to the right. Where it ends is our visual cue, where we aim with our throw aim. Once we do this wind bomb, we're going to turn Link mid-air to make it so that he's going to aim into the corner of this big square. This is going to be our visual cue in order to actually perform the wind bomb. Also important is our bomb timing. After we aim at the crack, we're going to do a normal front hop, but delay our first bomb and bullet time a little bit, which is usually not done. Once that's done, we aim into the corner and we look at our stamina. Once the stamina is basically at that halfway point, we want to detonate the first bomb, which is basically, hopefully, going to send Link all the way to the monk. This is how this trick looks most of the time. You will still make it, basically pretty close to the monk, but you won't have enough height to actually get to the monk. I will now show you a successful attempt of this. So we jump on the elevator pack, aim on the crack on the rock. We're gonna front hop, but delay the first bomb in bullet time a little bit. Place the second bomb, turn to the square corner, and before the stamina has reached the halfway point, we blow up the bomb, flying all the way to the monk. And you can see how fast this can be if you hit this wind bomb. So in a bad run, you can try to go for it. It will usually be slightly slower than the first setup I showed, because like you have seen when I first taught you this, you won't always land at the monk here. But if you do, you feel great. You save some time. So, I think this might be a good alternative to learn, to at least have in your arsenal of tricks that you can do if a run isn't going too well, but I do highly recommend the first wind bomb that I showed. Now, the next and last trick that has changed in the plateau is basically our movement from the bomb shrine to getting the paraglider. In the past, we would basically just walk up to the tree and then tree launch on top of the Temple of Time, which in my opinion, the tree launch there is still one of the hardest tricks on the entire plateau, which is why in the Amiibo route, you are now able to skip that trick, which I actually highly, highly recommend. You might even be able to skip this in a no Amiibo run, and I will tell you how, but let's look at the first wind bomb for the no Amiibo run at first. So the reason I'm already recording here after talking to the old man is the position that Link ends up in after talking to the old man is important for the wind bomb setup to get to the beetle. So this is once again for no Amiibo. This is exactly where you stand once you come out of bombs for the first time. If you look down, we kind of stand on this outer line of the shrine. This is where we stand, right, with Link's feet. Basically facing directly towards this rock. This is where you end up after leaving the bomb shrine. And this is how the setup to the wind bomb begins. What we're gonna do is we're gonna pull out our axe and then swing our axe and jump to the left. The reason we swing our axe while doing this is to make sure that our side hop will always be exactly the same. Now we are in this spot. What we want to make sure is basically that we are as close to the edge of this basically shrine lip as possible to begin our wind bomb setup. This is another turn wind bomb. So in order to do this wind bomb, you want to know how to turn wind bomb. Once again, look at Vivo's video. And we are basically going to use these bricks as a visual cue. So there's like this line here on the bricks. It's a little mossy, basically closes out the bigger bricks. And then just on top of these is a broken wall. And this broken wall, it's kind of like a triangle here. This is what we use as our visual cue for this wind bomb. So we aim at it with throw aim and get ready to do our wind bomb. We do the wind bomb. And once again, after placing the second bomb, we have to turn Link facing him to this crack in the boulder. This crack in the boulder is going to allow us to do a wind bomb that basically sends us into the forest here without taking damage. The problem with this is, in the no Amiibo run, sometimes the beetle, which is obviously what we want, isn't loaded. Because the game wasn't ready for Link to travel this fast from the bomb shrine all the way to this forest part. So there might be a beetle on this tree, but it might not be loaded yet, which can really throw you off. And once again, the beetle is just a very annoying part of the run. It just loaded onto this tree. That I personally don't like, which is another reason as to why I use the Amiibo rune in my speedruns. I'm going to talk about that more in the castle part of this tutorial. But just make sure if you do go for this wind bomb to the tree here, that the beetle might take extra long to load. So make sure to double check if all of the trees have a beetle or which tree has a beetle, and then make sure to obviously slowly approach it and then eventually get the beetle. Now from here, you could do the tree launch, the normal tree launch that I taught in my first tutorial. I'm not gonna go over it again. I personally hate the trick and I still miss it all the time. So I'm gonna show you an alternative. The alternative is to do a wind bomb to the Temple of Time. And this is much more useful in an Amiibo run because you don't even have to collect a beetle. But even if you have big issues with the tree launch, I'm going to show you this alternative strat. So this is going to look like a pretty long walk. After getting the beetle, you're going to run all the way back to this bridge, this broken bridge. This will still end up saving around 10 to 20 seconds over running all the way to the Temple of Time and then climbing up the ladder. So this still might be worth it if you really have huge issues with the tree launch, but you can do wind bombs pretty easily. This wind bomb will also be used in the movement for the Amiibo category, where we are basically going to make it so that our first wind bomb lands closer to this bridge because we don't need the beetle. So what we use is we use this broken, I want to say, pillar of the bridge and position Link in the corner of it. This is the corner we're going to stand in. And then we are going to make sure to aim our axe again. And once again, we're going to use the top and bottom lines of our crosshair. and we want to basically imagine a line between them. And that line we want to place exactly between the window in the Temple of Time and the broken window, like this. Imagine the line here between the top and bottom crosshair, and that's our setup for the wind bomb. Now, we want to do a normal front-top wind bomb, making sure to place our second bomb when Link's legs are fully straight to get the most optimal height from it. And Link will fly all the way to the Temple of Time without taking damage. Because the way fall damage in this game works is it calculates where Link started and where he lands. And since basically it calculates the difference between the apex of the launch and his landing spot. And since my apex of the launch was basically my landing spot, I didn't take any damage. So you can do this with only taking one heart of damage from the actual wind bomb. And you have the beetle, you made it to the top of the Temple of Time, and you can get the paraglider here. I will show you how to do this movement in an amiibo run, basically changing your first wind bomb where you don't get the beetle, and you can choose what you want to do. You can obviously, which is still faster, just do the first turn wind bomb I showed to the tree, get the beetle, and then tree launch up here. But if you do have issues with it, and you're pretty good at wind bombs, you can do the wind bomb that I just showed, even in a no amiibo run. But let's talk about amiibo for a second. Just like in no amiibo, obviously, you spawn here at this round line after talking to the old man, and then you run up to this wall, climbing it up. Now, if you have the DLC installed, this chest here contains the Nintendo Switch shirt. Not useful at all. But this chest happens to be exactly on the tile on this wall. That is our visual cue. But if you don't have this chest, I'm just going to throw it away. It's just going to be the first tile. Like, there's one tile here, one tile here. And this tile obviously has a line on the left and a line on the right. The line on the right is where we place Link's left foot. Like this. Then we use throw aim to aim at this Decade's Guardian's eye. We basically want it to be in the middle of the throw aim. We will do a delayed turn wind bomb here again, which is basically the same that the gamer wind bomb is in bombs. All that means is that we delay the first bomb drop and bullet time a little bit, okay? Once we do that wind bomb, we place the second bomb. We're gonna turn again. We're gonna turn Link to this patch of ivy. This is how this looks in fast. So we basically, we spawn here after getting the bombs rune. The old man talks to us. We run here, climb up the wall, place Link's left foot on the line, aim at the guardian eye, get ready to wind bomb, delay it a little bit, turn to the patch of ivy, and then we go flying towards this bridge. Now, in this case, I only took a quarter heart of damage. Sometimes you will actually take a little bit more damage. You will fly a little bit higher, a little bit lower. What is important is that you delay the wind bomb a little bit, because otherwise you will go too high and you might die from this wind bomb. In any way, these wind bombs are always a risk, right? They are fast, but you can die to them and you can lose a lot of time if you do so. You can always just run, and I actually recommend this for beginners, run all the way to this part of the broken bridge and only go for the second wind bomb. The second wind bomb is very consistent. The only thing that can happen sometimes is that you fall through one of the holes here, but it's very rare. You usually never take damage, and you can still save a lot of time over running all the way from the bottom to the top. And you still skip the tree launch, so in amiibo, that's something you totally can do. In no amiibo, you can just run here to the beetle, then run to the bridge, then do the wind bomb, or you do the first wind bomb, you do the tree launch. There are several options. I personally, in speedruns, because I do amiibo, I do this first wind bomb to the bridge that I just showed, and then I wind bomb from the bridge up here. You can do the split in around 1 minute and 40 seconds, and even lower with these strategies. What you really should be aiming for on the paraglider split is sub 2 minutes, depending on if you get the beetle or not. But that about wraps up all strategies that I recommend you to learn on the new 2021 Great Plateau. The route is pretty much the same, but these strategies may be worth it to pick up. I will, in around a month, basically upload the video for the new, completely new Hyrule Castle route, which is going to be a lot. It's going to probably be a 30-minute video with lots of information. So please be a little bit more patient. There is already tutorials out there, but I will upload my own. I was actually the person that came up with that route. Little tap on my shoulder for myself. But I'm excited to teach you guys all about that. If you have any questions, make sure to put them in the comments below. Join the Breath of the Wild speedrunning server where you can post your clips when something isn't really working for you. And make sure to watch me live on twitch.tv/limcube when I speedrun several different categories in Breath of the Wild and also some Skyward Sword HD now. You can always ask me questions there or just hang out. I appreciate it. I hope this helped and is able to save you a little bit of time in your speedruns. Thank you for watching this updated 2.0 tutorial. And I'll see you guys in the next video.